Okay, so I guess today I just want to follow up with some of the things that I just indicated yesterday, where I introduced some of the, you know, from our perspective, advantageous properties of colloidal plasmonic particles in cellular biophysics. And in my lab, we are basically pursuing two different directions. One is for imaging application. And the other one is actually for using these particles with very defined surface properties to manipulate cellular processes. And then the optical properties of the particle basically come for free to quantitate these processes. And I think, you know, one of the previous speakers already highlighted, you know, for plasmonic particles, we optically active. You really talk about particles of a diameter of a 30 nanometer or something. So you do need to think a little bit, you know, where actually, what kind of applications, are the best possible applications for these kind of materials. I mean, undoubtedly, they have very advantageous optical properties, but nevertheless, you know, they don't necessarily fit all possible things that you might want to measure. And so one thing that we are very interested in my group is to understand how cells basically regulate signaling, okay? And it turns out that the cell basically uses the cell surface as basically like a switchboard, if you want to, okay? So the cell can initiate very different signaling processes even though you target the same receptor, okay? So a ligand binds to a receptor. Depending on how these receptors are organized on the surface, you might get different outcomes. We don't really understand exactly how the cell regulates now these protein organizations at different models that people have developed. I mean, there's a lipid raft model, there's a picket fence model, or a protein island model, so different cellular components contribute to a spatial organization of these surface proteins, and probably all of these things, you know, will play a role and be important. And so from our point of view, what we would like to be able to measure is basically we would like to quantify how clustered are these proteins, and we're particularly interested in an epidermal growth factor receptor on the surface. And when we ask this question, we don't really need to know, you know, so in EGFR, for those, you know, that are more familiar with this receptor, it's a receptor tyrosine kinase, which is activated by dimerization. So we're not really interested in this molecular picture knowing, I mean, are these no dimers or not. What we would like to know is how is the local density of these receptors distributed on the surface, okay, and for us, you know, these islands on the cell surface that have dimensions of tens to hundreds of nanometers are basically hotspots, if you want to, a different kind of hotspot, hotspots where you have a higher affinity of particle binding to the surface, okay, and as a consequence of that, what we try to do is we basically map optically, the distribution of the receptors on the surface. So basically these areas, these corrals or compartments, will induce a patterning of our nanoparticle clusters, and using the techniques that I introduced in my previous talk, we can actually optically detect those. Well, that's the goal. And why is it important? I already alluded to that. Don't want to talk too much about it. I just want to highlight that the cell surface is very complex. And the cell uses this complexity to organize things together and to modulate signaling. So if you have low concentration, you have a different signal and different signal strength than if you have a certain area where you have high density of these receptors. And so, you know, we have tools to monitor that. And, people have actually used, metal particles. I mean, this might actually be one of the first applications of gold particles in biology as a contrast in electron microscopy. So in this particular case, you know, they have a sheet of a cell surface and they label different things with antibodies, so immunolabels, and, you know, they have two different sizes, and, you know, here they basically want to see, you know, how are these big things and the small things distributed relative to each other, and from that they want to deduce certain information about interactions between these labeled species. Now we can do super resolution microscopy. So the problem with this approach is that you have to fix the cell. You have to bring it in the SEM that might perturb your sample. So there are some problems associated with that. Today we can do super resolution, which is great if you have the time to do it. And one problem in cellular biophysics, if you, for example, you would like to do a cancer scan and you would like to know this distribution of the receptors to get some diagnostic information, measuring one individual cell for a couple of hours is not really the way forward. We need to have approaches that can rapidly, ideally something like a flow cytometry or something, give us information about thousands of cells in a very short time. Okay, so that's basically, so there's a need for other technologies, although this very impressive success of fluorescent super resolution microscopies. And this took this slide from my previous introduction. So basically our idea is very simple. We basically want to use this distance dependent coupling between the particles just to basically probe organization of these receptors, and we would like to basically just take a hyperspectral image of a cell surface. Okay, we have the resolution dictated by optical microscope, and we would basically then try to encode information about the receptor density in that focal spot, which is on the order of hundreds of nanometers, by basically spectral analysis of our receptors that are bound to our target receptor. So if you have a green spot, that means you have low density of your particles bound there. If you have a red spot, that means you have high density. Okay, and so we can read that out very efficiently. I mean, the traditional way is you can use a spectrometer, but obviously this is very cumbersome and is not really consistent with this high throughput that I just indicated. So what we do nowadays is basically we do some sort of a hyperspectral imaging where we either use a filter wheel or we use a tunable filter, and we take images at defined wavelengths. This is shown here. So each of these red dots is basically one image of these individual particles. And we can basically reconstruct a fairly broad plasmon from that. And the individual dots here is basically for comparison a spectrum of the same particle recorded in a conventional spectrometer. So we get equivalent information, but in this way we can basically scan the whole field of view in a few seconds. So that means we can do quantitative imaging with this approach. And one important thing is, and I cannot highlight that enough, if you want to use this approach, you have to make sure that your particles are colloidal stable. Okay, so because our approach basically utilizes the clustering on the cell surface to obtain information about their distribution. So you have to make sure. What I show you here is basically comparison of some pegylated particle where we introduce an antibody through conventional click chemistry, and we basically recover the particle after we have incubated them with a cell to check if there's any change. Okay, if there is a change, you have a problem, because then you don't know if that particle that you see on your cell surface is that clustered because it just agglomerated and fell down, or if it's really patterned by the cell surface. And so basically you don't see any shift in the spectrum, you don't see any shift in the DLS, and if you look at them under the SEM, you also see, if you do a statistical analysis, you see a random distribution. So that's what you want. You also want to make sure that these particles bind selectively. So here, just a typical competition assay on the left. We basically do a binding experiment to our epidermal growth factor receptor. In the absence of excess antibody, and on the right, we add additional antibody. And you can see that if we add this antibody in large excess, we can basically prevent the binding of our particles. So that means the immunolabels really bind specifically to the receptor. There's not just non-specific binding. And that's also important. Okay, so then you basically get images like this, and this is not so important. These are just basically different cell lines with different receptors. The more important point for the illustration how this works is basically just, so now you have this surface, and you basically have all of these different, little spots. And this is basically just an SEM. It doesn't correspond to this image, but it just it's just supposed to show you, that these different colors that you see now indeed reflect just different sizes of clusters, that are basically on the surface. And our interpretation of these clusters is that basically they map basically the compartments, the size of the compartments of these proteins on the surface. And that's why I called it long range interactions. These interactions here, these colors are indeed on the order of tens to hundreds of nanometers. So beyond what you can do with conventional FRET. I mean, FRET is very good if you are interested in this molecular dimerization, but on this long-range interaction, it's actually not so good. So it's basically this is the resolution limit that you're probably all aware of in fluorescence microscope between the FRET and and you know, the confocal resolution. And so you can do this experiment for a couple of receptors, and you do see interesting things. So you see that this you know, this organization of the proteins is not always the same. So we target here the same receptor, but we see, for example, that for certain cell lines, although we have the same average density, so in, let's say, in a square micron by square micron, you have the same number of particles in this area, you do have very different spectral responses, okay? And the reason why that is basically that you have different forms of clustering of these proteins on the cell surface, okay? So you have the same number of particles, but they are distributed in a different fashion, okay? In this case, you know, they are more highly clustered, and in this case, they have less clustering. And what we're trying to do now is we're working together with clinicians to see if this clustering of these proteins has diagnostic information similar to what has been used for a long time for expression levels of biomarkers. Okay, so what we would like to do is we would like to add this long-range clustering as an additional biomarker in personalized medicine applications. You can also understand this clustering by electromagnetic simulation. I guess in this kind of group here, I don't need to talk too much about it. So basically, we just assume different random clustering levels, and you know, we predict what the far field response would be, and then we see that the experiment basically fits to one of these curves, and from that we can basically deduce what the typical clustering level in the actual experiment is. And you can also look at the SEM, but again, we would like to do things all optically, that we don't have to prepare samples for the electron microscope. You can look at like dynamic processes. So one of the components that basically spatially organizes the membrane is cholesterol concentration. Yeah, so local differences in the cholesterol will change the composition of the membrane, and you can use something like M-beta-CD, which is basically this little tubulus tube formed like molecule. It can basically suck out the cholesterol out of the membrane. If you do that, then you generate basically a gradient, so the cholesterol from the left will go to the right, so you basically make everything homogeneous as a consequence of that. Okay, and sure enough, if we do this, then we see that we have a blue shift. Okay, so initially our particles, some proteins are preferentially localized in one of these two phases, and if we remove them, basically we see that this clustering goes away because now our particles are no longer preferentially clustered, but they're more homogeneously distributed. So that's basically a lipid raft disruption of a particular receptor, CD24 in this case. So that was basically the first application area, which is related to imaging. And I mean, believe me, I can give you many more examples where we do this, but I guess you get the overall idea. Now I want to switch a little bit to using this particle basically as a tool to manipulate and control cellular processes. And this is basically a collaboration that I have with a HIV virologist. And what we try to do is basically if you want to reverse engineer a virus particle and then use it as a defined model system to learn about the biological system. Because the problem with the virus is, although it's a simple life form, it's still very complex. Okay, so if we can assemble it and we know what is on the surface, then we can get deeper insight into the biology. And so also as a person that has been thinking about things in nanotechnology and particles for quite some time, I really like viruses because, I mean, they can do all of the things that we struggle with very, very easily. They do that very efficiently. So they can, they have multivalent presentation, they don't have any problems with stuff sticking to them, they can target very efficiently and selectively what they want, and they can escape endosomal pathways. So that means, they can very efficiently deliver their genomic information into the cell. I mean, we struggle with each individual of these points. So, but I also think, that if we have, a very well-controlled nanoparticle, then, the biology or the virology can benefit from us, material scientists, because we can basically assemble, if you want to, define model systems, and then you can see, what kind of molecule triggers what kind of a biological response. Okay, so it's basically a test tube kind of approach. And as a physical scientist, I like that, because then we can basically, if you can build a car, then you know how it works, right? So that you can same kind of approach. And so, and the problem that we have been investigating with these things is basically HIV. I mean, it's a virus, you probably all know about it, it's an envelope virus. And for a long time, people thought that there's a glycoprotein that the HIV virus encodes, so that it forces the host cell to make this virus protein, which it then basically puts into a surface. So these are these little purple things here. How much, Andrea, is there?
10.
Okay, good. Fantastic. Okay, so they make these little purple things, and for a long time, you know, biologists thought that this protein basically is responsible for, you know, triggering, finding basically the host cell and inducing uptake and then, you know, releasing the entire cellular process. And there's one problem with this. If the HIV virus would look like this, so with lots of these GP120 proteins on the surface, it would not work, because our immune system would immediately recognize this as a virus, and it would, you know, basically get rid of it. Okay, so the virus basically has to hide these proteins, and they're usually only something like 3 or 4 copies of this protein on the cell surface. So that kind of creates a dilemma for the biologist, because this virus is still very effective in targeting its host cell, although it has a very low number of proteins to do that. So how does it do that? And the question and the idea that you know my biological coworker had was, well, it's you know, it's basically this ganglioside, this lipid that the virus basically takes from the host cell when it buds. So bud mean, so the virus infects the cell, it basically enforces the virus, this host cell, to make virus particles, and at some point the virus basically goes out of the cell and it basically takes the surface, the membrane, with it. Okay? And apparently the virus has learned to parasitize some of these vesicle-based information processes that just go on in our body all the time, because, you know, cells have to exchange material, information, and so forth. Okay, and that makes sense, because if the virus utilizes this ganglioside, and the most important thing is actually this small molecule, it's basically sialic acid, yeah, here, actually there, that's, you know, that's the, you know, that would be advantageous, because you know, we use this a molecule all the time for information exchange. And so we did a very simple experiment. We took the simplest possible nanoparticle to test this. It's basically just a liposome, and this liposome contains GM3. And sure enough, what you see if you incubate your virus now with this in the presence of these liposomes, your infection goes down. So these white circles here, these white symbols, are basically infection measured in different assays. And basically, we can prevent the virus from multiplying by efficiently outcompeting it with these liposomes. So that was good. But I guess, you know, I was interested in, you know, can we learn more about this by, you know, tracking this process? And I think one of the earlier talks also, you know, highlighted the advantage of using optical tracking approaches to learn about mechanisms of biological surfaces. And I thought, well, if we now have this HIV virus, I mean, can we do something that looks very similar? We take a gold core inside, and then we build basically a lipid membrane around it, and we basically just put our GM3 here inside. Then we should have a very nice optical probe that we can use as a tool to basically interrogate what, you know, the GM3 actually does inside of the cell. So, and we made different approaches to make this particle, and the simplest possible is basically we use a strategy that was developed by Catherine Murphy. So it's basically fairly simple. All you do is you make liposomes, you take gold particle, you take some thiol, and then basically you have a self-assembly of this lipid layer on the particles. So we tested then, you know, this is not a very good image, but we took some fluorescent molecules into this lipid layer, and we do optical colocalization. So basically we're looking for the presence of both the metal particle and the fluorescent signal. Then we know that we have basically assembled the membrane, and we do this with something efficiency of 89%. You can also see something in the TM, not in this TM, but if you would have a higher quality TM. But as, you know, also was indicated, not sure what that means, right? Because ATM imaging of soft material is very, very difficult. But this is very, very convincing. Okay, and one point I also want to make is because I mean for those of you that work with nanoparticles in biological environment is we spend all of this time of making these nice very surfaces and then we basically put it into an animal or something and all of that is gone because lots of proteins stick on the surface. So one of the key advantages of these membrane-wrapped particles is that most lipids are twitter-ionic, and there has been some extensive research in the biomedical community that is twitter-ionic due to its presence of both negative and positive surfaces can kind of protect surfaces from protein adsorption. And sure enough, if we compare our particles, and we're looking at this so-called corona, I mean, we do have a little bit, this is basically control without proteins, so we do have a little bit of this formation if we're looking at the hydrodynamic diameter. But if you compare that with conventional PEGs, we do a fairly good job in preventing this corona formation. Okay, so that means we have a way of kind of passivating the surface and preventing non-specific protein absorption. And then we test. I mean, in vivo, we're looking at basically at this mouse, and you see this kind of white area here. So here we're basically injecting these particles both on the left and the right side. You see that they kind of go into the lymph node. If you just inject them on the right side, you see it here. You can cut out this lymph node. You can do ICP-MS, and you can basically test if this binding to this receptor that this sialic acid recognizes, which is the so-called CD169. And you see that you have a ligand a receptor-mediated interaction, because if you leave away this GM3 on your particles, then you have much lower gold concentration. Okay, so that basically this simple particle where you induce a GM3 into a membrane basically works in vivo as well as in vitro. And so one thing that really struck us is if you now take these particles and you incubate them with a dendritic cell, which also was introduced in one of the previous talks, which is basically an antigen-presenting cell, and these antigen-presenting cells, they express this CD169 in very high copy numbers, then something very peculiar happens. So initially, the particles are everywhere, and then the cell kind of collects them into kind of these little clusters. Okay, so initially we thought, and it does, we quantify the time, and look at the actin dependence, so that's all fine. And we thought, maybe what we have here is just, they end up in the endolysosomal pathway, so they're degraded. Okay, but when we did fluorescent staining, and there are clear markers for the end for the lysosomes, then you can see that these metal clusters, they're very far away from these lysosomes, okay? So this is a unique compartment that has nothing to do with a lysosome. And if you if you basically cut your dendritic cell, the dendritic cell is called dendritic cell because it has these dendrites here on the surface, then you see that these metal particles here are basically right next to the membrane, okay? So they're in invaginations close to the membrane. Keep that in mind, because you will need that for the big bang of this presentation later. So another interesting thing is if you basically take a fluorescently labeled virus particle, so this is now the real deal, and you mix them with your particles, then you see particle, virus, okay, and then they co-localize. So these particles, just inclusion of GM3 is sufficient to recapitulate the trafficking of the virus particle. And I should also say that this is unique to having a metal particle inside. So I always show this slide here because, obviously I like working with metal particles, but the question is, do you need it? And you absolutely need it. If you have just liposomes, they just get endocytosed and they end up in the lysosome. So we don't know if this has something to do with the mechanical response, if it has something to do with the fluidity of the lipids. We're looking all into these things. Right now we just know that you need to have some kind of a core and wrap the membrane around it. So, so basically, what we have shown in this study is that so people for a long time biologists were wondering how does a virus actually so efficiently transfer from the dendritic cell, which is basically not its not its host cell, but it uses it to basically go to the lymph node, where it actually targets is its T cell, which is the actual host cell. How does it do that? And so basically there are three different models that the biologists have come up with. The first one is maybe the virus is somehow endocyte host by this dendritic cell, and then finds for some reason a way to escape the endosomal pathway and to kind of, you know, find a way to the surface and be transferred to the T cell. And I mean, we can clearly say that this is not the case, because we don't find these membrane wrapped metal particles in the lysosomal compartment. So this is not consistent with our observations. The second model that people suggested is, well, maybe, you know, the virus just, you know, sticks to the dendritic cells. The dendritic cell goes from peripheral parts of the body to the lymph node, and then it kind of, you know, jumps over to the T cell. And again, that's also not consistent, because we do see that our clusters that basically show the same behavior as the virus particles are localized below the plasma membrane. Okay, so this is also not what we see. So what we do see is the method that you know makes most sense, is most consistent with our observation, is shown here, that basically the dendritic cell collects these virus particles and our nanoparticles. So apparently this process is GM3 CD169 mediated. It collects them in deep membrane invaginations, which somehow remain accessible to the surface, so that when the T cell comes and it tracks the surface, they can transfer. I'm running out of time. I also actually have nice data that shows you that even the particles do the same thing. They can actually, you know, bind to that interface between the T cell and the dendritic cell, but I'm out of time. And I just show you this image here, which basically here the dendritic cell, here the T cell, and this is basically the cluster right at this so-called biological synapse, which now we're trying to target for therapeutic purposes. Thank you.